Louisiana, decided to name his son Huey as well, you know, so that's how Huey got his name.
Right on the opening flap of this book, you talk about August 22nd, 1989. Mm-hmm. What happened?
August 22nd, 1989 was the day that Huey Newton approached. He went to West Oakland. He'd grown up all over Oakland. And by this time, we're talking about a Newton who had, he'd been in jail. He had come out of jail for the shooting of an officer, a police officer in Oakland. And it was while he was in jail, the Black Panther Party became the national party that everybody remembers because he professed that he did not kill this officer. And we have to understand that this is 1967, the fall of 1967. You had a number of different groups who saw the police as their enemies. You had the anti-war, young whites and anti-war movement, and you had young black militants, both of whom said, well, the police are our enemy. And they kind of latched on Huey Newton as a hero for being accused of shooting this police officer. So Huey Newton became this icon that everybody looked up to. And when he came out of jail, on a technicality in 1970, because he had been convicted of manslaughter, when he came out of jail, he was a person that was celebrated by radicals everywhere. I mean, it was the thing to have your anti-war button on the one hand, free Huey button on the other, or if you were black, a young black person, your black power button, and along with that, your free Huey button. So Huey came out of that, came into a celebrity world of limousine liberals, of Hollywood liberals who kind of latched on to him. But at the same time, he developed a very heavy drug addiction. Now, he had always been, he had been a petty criminal. And by petty criminal, I mean a person who engaged in short change scams in Oakland. He had done that while he was in high school and on up into his early 20s. But then when he came out and became a person who was an icon of the beautiful people, he became heavily addicted to cocaine. He had tried drugs before, but he did not become addicted anywhere near to the extent he became addicted in 1970 when he came out of prison. And he became a virtual monster in a lot of ways. I mean, he just, the side of Huey Newton that could engage in evil activity, it just accelerated because cocaine makes a person very paranoid. He engaged in a lot of sexual abuse. He engaged in the ordering the murder of people within the party, and in the cases of some people outside of the party.
Let me interrupt to ask you, how do you know all this?
Because of out of talking to people who were actually in the party, and out of going over court records and uncovering the evidence that he actually engaged in this. There's plenty of evidence around that Huey Newton did. He was accused and charged with plenty of killings, and accused and charged with embezzling money from a school that the Black Panthers had.
How many times was he convicted of something?
He was convicted. Okay, he was convicted in 1967. He was convicted as well of stabbing Odell Lee in 1964. This was a misdemeanor conviction. He was convicted of a very minor charge in about 1987-88. So he was convicted of something probably about 3-4 times. So he was charged with a number of different things. And
was he in, did he go to jail every time?
No, he didn't go to jail every time. He was out on bail for long periods of time. When he came out of jail in 1970 on the manslaughter conviction and shooting the Oakland police officer, and he was tried 2 times over again, and the trials resulted in hung jury, so the case was dismissed.
Go back to the August 22nd, 1989.
Okay, August 22nd, 1989, Huey Newton had come out of jail on a misdemeanor charge, drug possession charge. By this time, we're talking about a man who's very much addicted to cocaine. His organization no longer exists. You know, the Black Panthers were practically defunct by 1982. He's heavily addicted to crack cocaine. So he goes to West Oakland, and on this particular night that you're speaking of, and he tries to get some more cocaine, because what he's doing is he's not paying for the cocaine the crack cocaine the way most customers pay. And he's basically pressuring drug dealers to give him drugs, because, you know, I'm Huey Newton. It's basically his whole thing. It's like, I'm Huey Newton. I used to be king of the streets. You have to pay respect to me because of who I am. So drug dealers are giving him money, but it's a very complex thing. There's an organization organizations who are running drugs on the streets of Oakland. One organization is the Black Guerrilla Family, which is prison-based. Now, there are Black Panthers who became part of the Black Guerrilla Family while they were in prison, because there are a number of people who were in the Black Panther Party who ended up going to prison. Huey Newton, there's a lot of anger against Huey Newton because of him abandoning these Panthers while they were in prison and no longer allowing the Panther Party to take care of them and their families to the extent that they did before he got out of prison in 1970. So you have a lot of residual anger in the BGF resulting from that, as well as the fact that he's taking drugs from these guys without paying. So a contract is put out on the life of Huey Newton. And on this particular August night, a young man decides Tyrone Robinson decides to take up the contract because he thinks he's going to move up in the organization. And on that night, he puts three bullets in the head of Huey Newton, and Huey Newton dies.
How do you know that Tyrone Robinson did it?
Well, he was charged with the killing. He was convicted of second-degree murder. I went to the trial. I interviewed Willie Payne, who was actually with Huey Newton before he died. And as a matter of fact, Huey Newton crossed paths with Willie Payne the night that he died and decided to get the cocaine and come back to Willie Payne's apartment and smoke the crack cocaine.
Did you talk to Tyrone Robinson?
I did. I tried to talk to Tyrone Robinson, but I didn't get a chance to talk to Tyrone Robinson. All I did was hear his testimony and also go in court and also go to the court records. And because there's a lot of, there were different police reports and everything that as well as what I could glean from Willie Payne to reconstruct everything.
Did you go to the funeral?
I didn't go to the funeral of Huey Newton because I came to Oakland. He died in August. I came to the Bay Area in November, so I didn't get a chance to go to the funeral.
What was your reason for going to the Bay Area?
I came to the Bay Area because I had a tentative offer from Robert Maynard, the publisher of the Oakland Tribune, to write for the Oakland Tribune. I say tentative only because he said, well, as soon as I can open something up, I'd like to have you on my staff. So I was freelancing in New York City. I didn't have anything solid in New York City because everyone was telling me at the major papers, well, you have to pay your dues. You have to go out and leave New York and come and work your way back. So I thought Bob Maynard's tentative offer was the best offer that I had. So I decided to come to the Bay Area and wing it, go out to the Bay Area. And at the same time, the Panthers, since my birth name is Huey, the Panthers had kind of left my mind from my childhood, because in my childhood I had read practically everything I could get my hands on about the Panthers. So when Huey was killed in August, I was like, well, my goodness, what happened to this guy? What happened to the Black Panther Party? I want to investigate what happened to the Black Panther Party, as well as pursue this newspaper opportunity in the Bay Area. So that's what brought me to the Bay Area.
Did you ever think at any time in your life you wanted to be a Black Panther?
When I was, about 10... Well, I would say more 11 or 12 years old, during the heyday of the Black Panther Party, yeah, I thought, it would be great to be a Black Panther, because most of the media, particularly the media in the leftist community and the liberal community, most of the media gave you the impression that the Panthers were really great guys who were coming up with community programs, and that any kind of problems they were having with the police was because they were trying to do something good. So, yeah, I was very much into the Black Power movement, Black Power era, when I was 13 years old.
Did you have to be Black to be a member?
For the most part, you did have to be Black to be a member, but a lot of people don't realize that the Black Panthers were different than Black nationalists. The Black Panthers believed the system was at fault for the problems of Black people and poor people in general. They had a lot of white allies, and that's one of the reasons I think a lot of the white radical movements like the SDS, the Weather Underground, the Peace and Freedom Party, they created alliances with the Panther Party because the Panthers said, well, we believe that this is the system that's wrong and not white people in general. That is opposed to what happened in SNCC. Now, SNCC started out as an integrated organization, but eventually the leadership in SNCC decided to kick the whites out of the organization, and you had a number of different Black militant groups that didn't want to work with whites.
Got some pictures in here, some people, Meyer, that will be very familiar, and you mentioned SNCC, and I wanted to hold this picture up right here of Stokely Carmichael. Mm-hmm. What is SNCC, and what did he have to do with it?
Okay, well, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee was an organization that really, for the most part, started out as the youth branch of Martin Luther King's civil rights movement. As everyone is quite familiar with the story, 1955 was the year when most people chart the beginning of the actual nonviolent resistance to So it started out very much in alliance with Martin Luther King, and eventually started veering away from King, engaging in tactics that were more daring than what King and his disciples really wanted them to engage in. So eventually, you know, it started out that way. You had the Freedom Rides, which basically were started by CORE, but which were assisted by people in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. It went from there, went to voter registration projects, and it started out as an integrated movement. And Stokely Carmichael joined the movement early on, and basically he went into Mississippi, he went to Alabama, he was part of the Freedom Rides, and he became more and more militant. Now you had other people in SNCC, people like Bob Moses and John Lewis, who didn't become as militant as Stokely Carmichael eventually became, but he became more militant and steered SNCC towards a militant direction.
John Lewis, the congressman from Atlanta.
The current congressman from Atlanta.
Go back to Stokely Carmichael for a moment. Where is he today?
Stokely Carmichael's in Africa right now. He was in, I believe he was in Ghana for a while, but not right now, I'm forgetting the particular country, but it's in West Africa, I believe, where he is right now. Yeah, I think it's Guinea.
There's a hyphen to it. I don't know.
Guinea-Bissau, I believe
it is. But he started Black Power, the phrase Black Power. Uh-huh. What does that mean?
He and some of his disciples started.
What does that mean? Black.
Basically, it was, it grew out of SNCC's dissatisfaction with what had gone in 1964 at the Democratic National Convention. And SNCC, in alliance with some people in Mississippi who created the Mississippi Freedom Party, went to the Democratic National Convention having registered anywhere between 1 to 2,000 black voters and said, well, look, we are the true representatives who should be sitting and representing the state of Mississippi at the convention. And Lyndon Johnson said, well, look, I need the South. I can't handle this right now. We'll give you 2 seats at the convention. He dispatched Humphrey to tell him, we'll give you 2 seats. They wouldn't accept that. So they went, the following year, they went to Alabama to register voters in a third party effort. And they came up with the notion of black power as a means to campaign and get black people to see we need to empower ourselves. Now, eventually they became, because they didn't elect anybody in this third party effort, the effort through which they came up with the symbol of the Black Panther, and the reason they came up with the symbol was because you had a lot of illiterate blacks, and they decided, well, we have to figure out a way for these black people to recognize our ballot. So we're going to come up with the symbol of the Black Panther. So you had the black power, the notion of black power, the philosophy of black power, the symbol of the Black Panther that was initially used to register poor blacks in the Black Belt in Alabama, in Lowndes County. And that eventually, after the electoral efforts did not result in anyone being elected, then it was carried north and it became the notion of black power, empowering ourselves by any means necessary, even if it meant taking up the gun.
Where's your hometown originally?
I grew up in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
How long did you live there?
For 17 years, I guess 17 and a half years.
Parents, what'd they do?
My father's a physician. He's still a physician. He's 73 years old. He had his own private practice. Now he's the medical director of a hospital in Fort Wayne. He originally came from Georgia only. As a matter of fact, he settled in Fort Wayne only a few weeks before I was born.
Your mother?
My mother died when I was 17. She had a terminal illness for 8.5 years. So she was originally from Florida. She met my father when he was in medical school, and she was a nurse at Mary Medical College in Nashville.
What's your father's politics?
I would say my father could be classified as conservative. You know, a lot of people talk about the blacks who are conservative, and I would say he could probably be classified as conservative. I mean, a very self-reliant man who taught his kids to believe in themselves, that they could do anything they wanted to do. They were as good as anybody else. But my father's not the kind of person who had any, who would voice any kind of support for something like the Black Power Movement.
Brothers, sisters?
I have 2 sisters, one older and one younger. We're actually 3 now, because I have a little 8-year-old sister from my father's third marriage.
Where are your sisters?
I said both of them are in Atlanta, in the Atlanta area, in suburban Atlanta.
And what was it like growing up in Fort Wayne, Indiana?
Well, it was interesting. I think, as a matter of fact, I was thinking about this a few weeks ago. Indiana is basically seen as a pretty conservative state, and I think that politically that's pretty dead on. But growing up in Fort Wayne, I grew up in a small middle-class black enclave, and I went to predominantly white schools from nursery school on up. And, you know, there was some racial tension, but for the most part, there wasn't a whole lot of racial tension.